You can tell them we are live on Facebook.
I'm a I'll tell you to pay attention to what the Lord is going to do today. Because you have two of the best writers in Ghana who will help you to experience Ghana through their writing. Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, let's give a round of applause. Yes. And now the tomatoes we use to crack, you know. Most of the tomatoes are from Burkina Faso. So it's a great guy. Please give it up for me. Thank you for seeing now. Thank you very much. My name is Ojo Akutumwazi. If you go to Kumasi, I'm the unofficial Bifu ambassador. Yes. If you come to Accra, they claim I'm the headmaster. Nana Awere's head is almost as big as mine. So if I'm the headmaster, maybe he's the principal. And on behalf of Nana Awere, Damoah, Alba, and Kofi, I want to say a big welcome to all of you. And also on behalf of Jam Rock. Hi. You know, most of us love to listen to reggae, but we don't admit that we love reggae. When you go to church, most of the rhythms have the reggae, most of the songs you sing in church have the reggae feel. It tells you that Ghana, Jamaica, Ghana, those in the Caribbean, Ghana, those in the United States, and those in the Americas, we have a connection. Jam Rock is trying to bridge that connection by giving us a wonderful place called Jam Rock. Yes, I'll repeat myself a lot today because it's unscripted. So please, put your hands together for Jam Rock. Elizabeth, yes. We all know why we are here. Is there anybody here who doesn't know why he or she is here? If you don't know, please raise your hand. I'll buy a bottle of cloth for you. Oh, so you don't know why you are. Oh, you also don't know why you are here. And you too. You too, don't know why you are here. Please, keep your hands up. Waiters, waitresses, give each of them a bottle of cloth. Open more, open more, open more, because it's 1981. So today we are here for the book reading. Tickling the Sebiticalis. No, let me say that. Walk one. We tickling the Sebiticalis. Bim. Yes. Nana Awere has written a lot of books. Alba as well, and Kofi Akpabli. Personally, I've read all their books. I've been with them for some time now. I've been to most of the reading events. And I can tell you that it's going to be a great time. So order a drink or something to eat. And have a great, great, great time. This event is being streamed on Facebook and is sponsored by MTN. Everywhere you go, MTN has been in Ghana for 20 years. And now we have MTN 4G. You know, when you look at the advert on radio or see it on TV, when you listen to your radio or see it on TV, they say MTN 4G. But the CEO of MTN says it's MTN 4G. So we have MTN 4G, and they are streaming. You need to get MTN as well. We have Jam Rock, and we have our other partners. We'll introduce them and tell you about them as we proceed. So, ladies and gentlemen, we start with Kofi Akpabli. This one has been to every region in Ghana, and in the month of March this year, I had the privilege of traveling with him across the country. We toured 8 regions out of the 10. Yes, we shared a room as well. Yes, it was a great experience. He loves his food, he loves his walkway, he loves his watching. He loves palm wine and chill beer as well. And he loves his Ghana. Before I introduce him, let me say a big thank you to Honorable Defago Mashi, Deputy Minister of Culture, Creative Arts and Tourism. And we also have a great man in the house, the first black professor in Austria. Yes, he's a good man. You know, an Austrian left Austria and went to America and he became a dictator. And then later became the governor of California. Now, he's dead. He set the record in America. And you have a Ghanaian who has set the record in Austria for all blacks. His name is Professor Podomo. He said, the white first black professor in Austria. You are my translator for today, bro. Please. So let's welcome my friend, my brother, my mentor, Kofi Akpabli.
Thank you very much, Kofi. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We're excited to be here. This one started 3 years ago, and we are very grateful that it's picking up. It's picking up. Already, we have a request to come to some other regions. We're starting with Kumasi on the 24th of September. And for the first time, we have a guest reader, Alba. You'll be hearing her in a minute. And we'd like to see. Relax, enjoy, and take something away from here tonight. With that, I start the reading. My very first is coming from Romancing Ghanaland, The Beauty of 10 Regions. This is a book that was launched 2 years ago, and I'm taking the very first chapter. It's titled The Healing at Play. There is something at Lee Waterfall that connects with the soul. Something surreal and yet so real. Something soothing that snaps a bouquet of emotions. It makes you thirst to see the water again. It makes you hunger for nature's food for thought. This craving led me to the waterfall again. This time, I was alert to unravel the mystery of belief. I went with a critical observational stance that, oh, it's just another waterfall attitude. But at the end, I bowed as I was bowled over by the spectacle. The magic lies in witnessing tons and tons of water pour down in an awesome perpetual splash. That splash engulfs a large circumference, creating a calm, cold room of an atmosphere. By being there, one is odorized with a refreshing spray of white water. Thus, added to the music of the water rush in a large forest, creates a Garden of Eden effect. When the wind blew, it threw a gust of refreshing dew across my face, seeping into my skin. I was wet, yet I wanted more. My t-shirt hugged my body. There was no complaining. Without tasting it, I could sense the cool sweetness of the water. I thought I would be raptured up to meet the plunging grandeur. In one blissful embrace, I had a strange feeling that something was about to appear. A face above the source of the water. A mystical face looming high and large. For one moment, I felt like an Israelite waiting for Moses to descend after a face-to-face with God. Still standing in the shadows of the mighty form, I witnessed another spectacle. Far above and through the hills, a battalion of bats had taken position. They were there as if they were not. Hundreds of them, all motionless, no flapping, no flying, no floating. They clung to the cliff as if captured in a time capsule. I believe they were floating out in sounds, but oh no, no sound could rise above the gushing of the great cascade. I dropped my gaze only for my eyes to find another feast at the foot of the mountain, an inviting pool. This had been created as the water hits the ground. Because the falls vertical journey is over a great height, the water actually breaks up into a white spray before collecting once more in the swimming pool below. As it does that, strong winds created by the uproar within the gorge spray the water on the visitor. Same way a priest dispenses holy water to a congregation. One such spray touched me and I thought of simulating the sign of the cross. I didn't, but I still felt healed, detoxified. Suddenly, my fibroid of stress loosened up and rolled away. This city accumulated affliction brought about by polluted air, car fumes, open gutters, plastic waste, rubbish heaps, irritating noise and puzzling human parasites was no more. I felt empty and stressless. If standing before the eternal libation was my theater of treatment, the walk from the receptive center to the water sport itself is first aid. The thing about glee is that before the experience, you would have been prepared. There is a warm-up of a long winding walk under rainforest canopies. Three shapes totally block the sun and the sky. This trek takes about 40 integrating minutes. It involves crossing 9 bridges that span small streams, some migrating from Togo. What this therapy work does is exercise the lungs and strengthen the heart. The visitor inhales fresh, oxygen-rich air. As you walk, the fallen leaves under your feet cushion your steps, and the roar of the waterfall urges you on. Then the cries of forest animals serenade you. If you are lucky, a butterfly or two will touch your body with a kiss. Thank you very much.
Hello and good evening, everyone. Since Kofi has started us off with a travel story, I will try to replicate what he has done. So I read from I speak of Ghana, and it's about a trip I made with a family to the Volta region. So the title is Tourism Brewed in Kofi's Toga. When I was a kid in primary school, I read one of those textbooks we use for English lessons. This wasn't one of the regular ones. Thinking back, I believe strongly that my sister Georgina might have brought it from Nigeria, where she lived and taught for many years in the 80s. Some textbooks had passages per chapter, which we were supposed to read and then answer questions on those stories. Comprehension, we called them. One of the passages made an impression on me. A father took his wife and kids in his car on a journey across his country, going from town to town, visiting interesting sites and teaching his children the story behind those towns and sites. He spent the night in selected towns and hotels. A bit like the novel Around the World in 80 Days by French writer Jules Verne. This time, the tour was within the country, Nigeria, I think. Way back when I read that passage, I determined that I would do that with my family one day. I will come back to this story and what happened to this inspiration later in this article. When I was with Unilever, I visited Cote d'Ivoire once for a meeting. In conversations with the PA to the supply chain director, she mentioned that she was starting her leave the next day after we arrived. There were a few issues we needed help on, and we asked whether we could still call her while she was on leave, or if she could do us a favor and pass by the office to sort us out. "I'm sorry, I'm traveling to France," she said. I realized how different Ghanaians were amongst the West African states with respect to how we spend our leave. Perhaps where the trend where people travel abroad for vacation is going up, and I may be the odd one out, but it doesn't seem that it's a main point amongst most of my friends, who spend their leaves either in Accra or Tema. And time spent with the kids revolve around visiting the Accra Mall. The best one The first one that's out of the ordinary is to visit the village for a weekend. So for the first time in my working life, I decided to take leave beyond 50 working days to spend some quality time with the family. And I latched on to my childhood desire to show my children a bit of Ghana on an excursion and not to leave it to the schools to do that on my behalf. With the help of my friend, Kofi Akpabli, and Tekku Pasa Senior, we designed a tour of a part of Volta Ranger to cover 2 days with a sleepover at Hohoi. So we set off to book an accommodation. I asked a friend of mine who linked me up to a friend in Hohoi who booked Grand Lodge for us. Quite early on the day of travel, the kids were up and needed no prodding to take their bath and their breakfast. We connected through the Flower Road from Darwinia, went to the Fenya Road, went to Michelle Camp, and turned towards Akosombo. Our first point of call was the Shire Hills Forest Reserve, where the forest guard spent a few minutes telling us about the history of the area. He then indicated that the tour would take a couple of hours and it was best to do it early in the morning or in the evening. And just in front of the forest reserve, we sighted baboons. Some of the female ones had babies who were being carried under their bellies. The red bump of the baboons was the main talking point among the kids. They agreed that the baboons were nice, but their bumps were hot. Later in the day, I asked my eldest son, Danapami, what he enjoyed about the first day, and he told me it was the traveling. In addition to that, I enjoyed the conversation at the back of the car between the kids. Kids do have the nicest of conversations. Never underestimate their intelligence and the inquisitive turns their mind take in their perambulations. Finally, my best moments in the car were the opportunities to tell the kids some story or some history. As we approached Atipoku, I asked them if they knew about the longest suspension bridge in Ghana, as far as I know. None of them did. I told them it was the Atome Bridge and we were going to drive over it. Danapami and his friend Jonah went into an argument about how long it could possibly be. The winning length was 500 meters. I had no idea till then that they knew about meters much more to estimate them. Danapami was afraid it would take so long that it would frighten him. Later, when we had passed on it and took pictures by it without any fears, it was a good point to teach him a lesson that most times our fears are bigger in our imaginations than in reality. As we went around the Sukuma Junction, I called a friend who I called the mayor of Hope, Kofi Bedema. He knew that the region like his facility. I wanted to know where I could get the tastiest jollof rice in Hope. And this was for the sake of my son that I have. Was in Windsor Hotel, and he was right. But one had to wait for an hour, but the food was worth it. Fried rice also featured on our table with grilled chicken and grilled tilapia. We left home around 4 p.m., having belched at best with satisfaction. Our drive took us up the hill and descended to Pevern. Lovely scenery, the kids loving the climb up and the view of the terrain below. We turned right into Pebe and then on to Hohoi. The next day, the kids were up early and soon were coordinating the bathing and dressing But because Grant's Lodge didn't sell meals, we had to find a place to have breakfast before setting off for Taffy Atomen, our first intended point of call to see the monkeys. The receptionist directed us to Bomb Dog's restaurant on the rooftop, and we left the lodge around 8 a.m. to find the restaurant. Jollof, of course, Banku and Okro stew, fortified with tilapia and okro. Of course, how can you visit the squirrel and not partake in the feast of gods? Thank you.
Nana, thank you very much for whetting our appetites. What you couldn't tell us was whether we tried that special local gym while we were there in the VR. On that note, ladies and gentlemen, I'll take my second reading from Tickling the Ghanaian Encounters with Contemporary Culture. And I take an article that is entitled, What is Right with Appetition? I read, no one ever swallowed appetition and smiled. At best, the reaction is a grimace or a frown. Some drinkers acknowledge receipt by blowing out air or pounding the chest. Such is the potency of the local gin that all senses are put under instant attack. But it does not end there. Appetition is positively notorious that given the chance, its patrons would rather consume it in secret. To begin with, the local gin has a tall list of accusations, which is almost incriminating. Kill me quick, Ogoglu, Appeal, VC10, Efienipa, Kala, Kumi Prepun, Amferiwasi, Appeal Titi, Homeboy, Nana Drogo, One Touch, Soda B, Holy Water, Liquid Fire, Y2K, Agba, Yahoo.com, Sobolo, Man Pass Man, African Eyes, Quick Action, Yes We Can. The above is just one paragraph of accolades accreditation answers to you. For the information of the general public, this list is by no means exhaustive. When one turns to the various Ghanaian languages, there are more. If the drink has so many names, it only shows that it means so many things to so many people. Akpabli then becomes a kind of that I shall be all things to all people. Indeed, the drink's very name is derived from its contraband history. In the days of yore, when Britannia ruled the shore of the Gold Coast, they found appeal abominable. The open secret was that Akpabli was too competitive for their imported beverages. They knew that leaving the drink all alone would be a marketing disaster. They therefore banned it. Oh yes, they did. So when, in March 1957, Ghana, our beloved country, gained independence, Akpabli also became free forever. Connoisseurs tend to liken Akpabli to Russian vodka. Whether this is a compliment or not is a matter of debate. In Tokyo, I remember ever giving a sample of the drink to a friend from Brixton. Soon after recovering from the initial effects, Boris, sat in air and with eyes all reddened, asked, "This your national drink?" Conscious to defend my nation's pride, I did not know whether to agree or deny. One powerful element of appeal is the smell. When unconsumed, the drink cannot be said to smell that badly. But as soon as appeal enters the mouth, an abominable chemical reaction occurs, which smells almost devilish. The fumes is more provocative when one is boxed in an air-conditioned room. According to local experts, the following can be chewed to offset the smell: granite, ginger, and corn on the cob. Trying to subdue the smell with chewing gum and peppermint is a wasted effort. As for brushing up the teeth after Kodeshi, there is no worse remedy. It provokes the smell. Perhaps if there is one factor that restricts big men from the product, it is the scent. Actually, the relationship between Akpabli and big men is a curious one. Though the brand is seen as mass-oriented, in practice, a good number of consumers happen to be prominent folks. They usually use it as foundation while enjoying their more prestigious drinks. There is this standing rumor of a past Ghanaian head of state. Apparently, this first gentleman had a little fondness for Akpabli. The only problem was that the exigencies of high office were depriving him of the local gym. As the story goes, this commander-in-chief once bumped into an old friend who used to be a drinking pal. Contrary to such encounters, it was not the ordinary citizen, but rather the ruler of the land who had an urgent request. He bemoaned how the high office has deprived him of the good old staff. Would his trusted old friend be kind enough to undertake a small national assignment? Could he secure and discreetly deliver a gallon of Akpabli for old time's sake? And whilst at it, could he bear in mind that the affair remained a state secret? Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
A friend came to Ghana for the first time and had a taste of the Ghanaian taxi driver on his first night in town. We got into a dispute with the driver, as usual, over the fare. The driver became offensive and was threatening to have us locked up. "Do you know who I am?" he yelled. My friend looked up, him up and down, and after some thought said, "You look like a taxi driver to me." This is from the book, The Imported Ghanaian, and it is my pleasure to introduce to you the writer, Albert Kulebu Supreme.
Since we've been on the topic of food, I think I'm going to follow the food and drink thing. And one of the things I look, hi! Sorry, my voice is. So, one of the things that really stood out to me when I first returned to Ghana was this thing: you're invited. One of the first things I noticed when I arrived back in the motherland was the generous nature of the natives. You know, when eating, they would always invite people in the vicinity, even strangers, to join them. Like, you could walk into your local McDonald's or KFC and be invited to take a bite of someone's burger or chicken leg. Now, with careful observation, I noticed that most people, when invited, would smile and not partake of the meal. Now, it didn't take very long for me to see this through this culture facade. You see, most of the time, I don't think they mean it, but, you know, they say it anyway. It's a bit like a rehearsed play. Then everyone knows their part. So you say to someone, you're invited. And the person, according to the script, should say with a smile, thank you, meaning thank you, but no, I'm not going to hit. It's all part of the culture, people say. But looking on that scene as a semi-outsider, it smells a little bit like hypocrisy. I mean, why invite someone to put their hands in your food when you really don't want them to? I mean, if an invited person deviated from the script and took up the offer, I wonder what the average Ghanaian would do. Now, that would be very interesting. So I went to lunch with a friend at one of the eateries at Trade Fair. We used to go there every day, and the young woman who always served us was called Albertina. On this particular day, we arrived late and most of the food was finished. My favorite meal has always been ambisio with palava sauce, tuna fish and boiled egg. I ordered this every day. We sat down, ordered our drinks, and the ever-smiling Albertina came to take our food orders. Much to my dismay, Albertina informed me the ambisio and palava sauce was finished. I feigned shock. And Albertina, taking me seriously, went on to explain in a very, very loud voice that the man sitting at the table over there had had the last of the ambisio and palava sauce. I looked at him, I cried. I can't believe it. Making sure that the man cared. He, of course, looked in my direction with slight embarrassment. I said, how can you do this to me? You've taken the last of my favorite dish. Now, anywhere else on the planet, the reply would have been, hey, that's not, you know, what the hell do you want me to do? Now, thinking I was a foreigner, the man smiled brightly, took the aquaba root, grabbed the shovel, and proceeded to dig a hole for himself. You're invited. I threw my script in the bin and said, thank you. I grinned and handed Albertina a plate for him to her to collect half of the man's food for me. From that moment, everything moved in slow motion. The place became so quiet, you could have heard a pin drop. Albertina was rooted to the spot and was tossing the plate from hand to hand as if it was a hot brick. Shock written all over her face, trying to mouth something, but the words refused to come. The man had also gone into a state of shock because he obviously didn't expect me to take him up on his offer. His knife and fork covered above his food and his mouth gaped open. I'm sure I saw several flies go in and out. With a John McEnroe look on his face, I said, you cannot be seriously thinking of sharing my food with me. At any moment, I expected the saliva, which was hovering nervously, stayed left from his mouth. In 2 minds as to when he would make his grand debut or not, to fall loudly from his gaping mouth onto the floor. And shattered the interminable silence my thank you had created. My determined face said, B-rated Western cliffhanger style, I'm going to share your food with me because you invited me. No, please, no, repeated our hero's eyes. You invited me and now you're going to pay the price. With all my will, I managed not to laugh and insisted that Albertina go and collect the food for me as I was hungry. Albertina was uttering unintelligible words. I was now walking from one foot to the other, looking around with a vacant expression on her face. Go and collect my food, I insisted. But she stayed glued to the spot and the man looked ready to faint. The place still held its breath and the man was stuck in the same position, cutlery hovering in the air. But the saliva had decided not to make his grand debut. Now the whole scene would have only lasted a few seconds. But for the man, it must have felt like an eternity. So feeling sorry for all involved, bound by the culture of your invited, I just decided to release them. I laughed out loud and said, oh, I was only joking. And then flashed a smile that could polish the gold on the side of Timbuktu. The eatery heaved a huge sigh of relief. Ah, that was a close one. And Albertina laughed nervously as she still wasn't too sure what my next move was going to be. The man laughed too loudly for comfort and started tucking into his food with a vigor I'd never seen before. Now, that scene was totally ironic and absurd. But for the amazing Ghana others involved, they must have thought I was the strange one. That day, I ate jollof rice with fish. And as the man left, he especially came to our table and said goodbye to me. Much later on in the afternoon, my friend laughingly asked, oh, but Alba, would you have really collected the man's food? What a question. Of course, he invited me, didn't he? Now, there's a little small note attached to this. You see, often if you don't follow the your invited script, you will be faulted. People will ask you to invite them so that they can say no. I don't get that. So two British girls were busy sitting there, munching their lunch when their Ghanaian friend said, oh, am I invited? And the obvious person looked flashed across their friendly faces. What? Am I invited? She repeated, grinning and nodding towards the food. Huh? They obviously haven't been here long enough. Am I invited? By this point, she was gesticulating like a lead in a bad kung fu flick. And pointing at their food. The penny finally dropped. Hip, 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 hooray! Oh, you want some food? Why didn't you say so? Join us. The Ghanaian green took an offer. Oh, thank you, she said, and went to sit at another table. The British girls were very confused.
Please give them a round of applause. And hey, I'm fighting. I'm not going to be sorry. I'm fighting. You know what? Please go. Kofi, when you were talking about Akpabli and you mentioned Russian vodka, you didn't talk about the fact that Akpabli is sometimes recommended by our local pharmacist, the Michelle Group. But you can never share a brew with one. That makes a petition supreme. Somebody shall tell me. And then you talk about the, I'm not ready to talk about the Akpabli Bridge. For those of you who have never been to the water before or to is it yes, that was a good area. Don't worry. The bridge, the pedestrian walkway at the Bashi, it's a mini Adonai bridge. Just that with the Adonai bridge, when you fall off, you will land in the water. But the one at the Bashi, no. Ben, thank you very much. Ben is a musician from Burkina Faso. For those of you who came late, please give a round of applause. You'll be playing for us later, but Ben, I want you to sit down now and relax. I'll call you later to come and play for us. So Grace Kennedy is here. Grace has set up the aloe vera, or is it the aloe drink stand? You can sample that. It's for free. And you know, Ghana, our motto is freedom and justice. Chris has removed the dumb and is giving you the free. So please sample that and enjoy. And when you buy one, you get one free. Just like one factory, one district. One Ghana, one people. One dumb rock, one wrong way. And we have the special Montezo Bologna. It's at the back. You should try that as well. She's sampling and you can buy some as well. AJ Housekeeping will clean the place up when we are done. And if you... Nana, please get up. Could you get up as well? Yes. But where is my shirt? You should give me a shirt when you have some of this event. Okay, so... So that is by credits, right? So the shirts, the costumes for both of them by credits. Please grab the credits. And we have MTN 4G. Yes, MTN 4G. Wherever you go around the country, you can get MTN 4G. I've been told that you need to give me the 360 degrees. Yes. No. Come. We are going to do a proper runway. And that runway needs music. So I'm going to sing for the two of them. Then you walk. Nana will go first. Guys, are you ready? So the runway starts from there to the other end, then we come back.
And I'll need you to clap as I rap. It's been a while since I did. Supai, it's the same insane. Don't tell me fancy. Don't tell me what I am. It will be. This is Supai, it's the same insane. Don't tell me fancy. You know what it comes to fashion? You can never hide the creativity of our fashion designers. So, Kofi, remember our big time? Okay. Are you ready?
Yes.
Are you ready? I said, to me, Obin Kevin Mami, Kofi, I told me, my name is Akpabli. I want to tell you, my rashes. I'm going to say, I'm very good. I'm going to say, 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 and please, a round of applause for Jamon as well. Uh-huh. Rasta. Oh. Yes, thank you. We are now in the first round. We are gonna have this.
to prevent you from crying. And they surely are in Ghana, because when he heard me,